This is
I guess while you guys are doing the game, I will just move on to the next slide now. There
yeah,
you go.
Cool. I'm happy to intro now. Okay, sweet. Cool. Can y'all hear me fine?
Yes.
Yep.
Yeah. Okay, sweet. So yeah, hello everybody. Welcome to UX Interview Tips Part 2, Acing the Take Home Design Challenge. Before we start today's session, I just wish to acknowledge the people of the Kulin Nations on whose land we are gathered today. My name is Christian and I'm one of the events officers at the Monash Association of Coding. We call it MAC for short, and we do appreciate you all coming today. Before we begin, I'd also like to introduce our club and who we are. So we are a coding club that focuses on imparting valuable technical skills and industry relevant experience to students. Our ultimate goal is to foster the programming culture at Monash and provide a collaborative setting for students to do projects and also to learn from one another. We do this by delivering technical workshops, and what sets us apart is that everything we do produces a result at the end of the day and also adds value. Don't forget to also check us out on our social media on the slides right now, and I'll be passing it over to Jasmine to begin today's session.
Thanks so much, Christian. Can you guys hear me fine? All right, so for those of you guys who actually weren't here last week, I just wanted to get a quick start, get started on the recap. So last week we covered a bit about UX projects, portfolios, and case studies. And basically what case studies are is just something that's documenting your UX project from start to finish. And just like every other documentation, it should have a beginning, middle, and an end. And this is really important for today's session. So basically what the beginning is it sets the context and helps your readers understand what the problem was, what your role was in the project, who your users were, what the timeline was like, tools used, and any other relevant information needed that, to help them like understand your case study properly. And also for the middle section of the case study, this is where you showcase your end-to-end process, you know, right from when you did all your research to designing it, to evaluating it and refining your final solution to your design. Also the end section is where you wrap it up. You show them your final solution, what the impact was, or also maybe a bit of a reflection. And like what the next steps are in terms of your project. We also covered a little bit about the UX interview process. In the UX industry, it's usually very straightforward. Usually you just like apply with your resume and your portfolio. And if you're successful, you go straight into the screening stage, which is usually just like a test of your culture fit. And you might also be asked to share a little bit about your, to talk a little bit about your past projects. And then at the very last stage, you might be asked like a technical challenge or something related to UX, kind of like if you're a coder, you might hear about like coding challenges or pair programming interviews. And it's the same in UX, so it's not a pair programming, but there are specific technical interviews that kind of test your UX skills. And last week we covered portfolio reviews. This week we'll be focusing more on the take home design challenge and just design challenges in general as well. So last week, if you weren't here for the portfolio review, all that is like you present your best projects in more depth than what is covered in your case study to the actual team that you're going to be working with. So if you weren't here last week, there's a recording available on our YouTube channel, Monash Association of Coding, so just feel free to check that out later after the session. All right, so for today though, what we'll be covering is we'll just extend on the UX interview from last week. So this week I'll be giving tips. I won't be covering all the stages, but just like general tips when you're starting out. And then I'll be also covering design challenges, you know, what to expect when you do them, what interviewers want, and kind of like a sample framework that you can use when you're approaching these design challenges. I'll also be covering like the design challenge that I submitted for when I was doing like these challenges and I was applying for roles, and I'll also cover some examples that the other designers have posted like all around the world. We'll also be doing like an actual proper collaborative design activity, hopefully. So for that section, we will be using Miro board. So because we are remote, we'll be using this online collaborative tool, but it'll still be helpful to have like a piece of pen and paper. So if you do want to go grab that now, you have a few seconds to find one, but if not, that's okay, because you can just use your iPad or whatever else you have in hand. And lastly, we'll also have like a Q&A section at the very end, but I'll be answering questions throughout the presentation. So feel free to pop your questions in this Cutly link at the top right. So if you just follow that link there, you'll be able to submit all the questions, and I'll just answer them every now and then throughout this event. Okay, so just a little bit of an introduction about me. So basically, yeah, my name is Jasmine. I'm studying IT, and for those of you guys who are not studying IT, that's also fine. It's actually really good to see like a huge variety of degrees everyone's studying. So your degree doesn't really matter. Like you can be a UX designer even from like whatever degree you're studying. So even from my degree, I didn't actually learn a lot of UX design processes, and I had to learn a lot of them myself. So it just shows you that it doesn't matter what your degree is, you can still be a UX designer. Yeah, and then before applying for UX internships, I was actually doing a lot of software engineering roles. However, very recently this year, I really focused more on like applying for product design and UX design roles. And so I went through a lot of different types of interviews, and I've done a couple of design challenges, and hopefully I can talk you guys through them today, and it'll help you like approach the interviews, but not just that, but also to help you kind of like improve your design thinking and methodologies for your other projects as well. And so, yeah, I think my passion for tech and design is really what drove me to UX. So for you guys, whatever your motivation is, I'm sure. But I really hope that you guys can kind of show that in your work as well. All right. So before we get started, I just wanted to like get to know everyone a little bit, kind of understand your background. So please go into the polls. Please go into the Flux polls, and the link is on your screen. Just fill in the polls really quickly, and then so I can understand a little bit better, you know, what your background is. And like I mentioned earlier, UX welcomes people from all backgrounds. It's really good to have a lot of diversity, because then that means that you can design for as many people as possible, and you can consider a lot of different experiences, and you can account for all of that. And overall, it makes you a better designer to have like an open mind and like diversity. Also, I want to know like why everyone's here today and what you guys want to hope to get out of the session. And lastly, I would also like to know like what your comfort level is with UX, so I can kind of tailor the workshop better to everyone. And so also, if at any point, if things get really confusing, like please call it out in the chat or just like anywhere. And then for all of our moderators today, just let me know if someone thinks something's confusing, and I'll just explain everything in more detail. Cool. So before we move on, I want to go to the Flux poll right now and see what the results were. How do I view the results?
So you click view 10 responses, and then you should be able to see it. Oh no, just like underneath the question.
Oh, okay. All right, cool. Thank you so much. So, okay, a lot of the people are studying IT, which is really cool. So whoever mentioned other, it'd be really interesting for you to write in the chat what you're studying, because that's pretty cool. And then for those of you guys answering right now, yeah, learn more about the interview process. Really cool. Okay. Yep. Sounds good. Definitely. We'll be doing a lot of side, hopefully you can do a lot of side projects, because in the UX industry, side projects is really what people look about and not so much your experience. Oh, okay. Cool. This is great. So yeah. And lastly, how much do you know about the UX design process? Oh, sounds good. Oh, there's one person who is an industry professional. I am very scared, but hopefully you can get something out of this workshop still. But yeah, thank you guys for answering. Really cool to see all your responses. And yeah, so we'll be moving on now to the actual part of the event. All right, so to start off, I'll be giving a quick tip for when you're applying to UX roles before we go in depth with design challenges. So, your top tips that I can give to you guys when you're applying for UX jobs is, number one, to use LinkedIn, because sometimes recruiters will reach out to you. I get messaged by recruiters quite a bit, so make sure your LinkedIn is always up to date with all of your latest volunteering roles, all the jobs that you've had so far. Make sure you have like SEO friendly descriptions as well, because like, you know, the better, like the more words you have in there that really fits what the recruiters are looking for, like the higher you will place whenever they're looking for a certain candidate. And so it's really good to have that as well. And finally, add links to your portfolio, your resume, and all your projects in there. Like there's actually a section on LinkedIn that showcases your projects. So take advantage of that. All of that stuff there, it's really useful to get noticed by people. Also, make sure you prepare your resume, because your resume is pretty much like the first point of contact usually with your recruiter if they didn't message you on LinkedIn. It says a lot about you as a designer. I can talk more about resume tips in depth in the end because it's not really the focus of today, but if you are interested, just mention that in the chat and then we can go through it towards the end of the session. And just to give you guys like a quick overview of like what my resume looks like, it's very succinct. As you can see, general tips is just make it one page, have all of your contact details at the top, make sure you state what you want as a UX designer. So for example, for me, I am a student and I'm kind of like very broad. I don't really have a specialization yet. And so I intentionally mentioned that, yeah, I want to be a UX designer. However, if you're a person who really wants to specialize with like maybe user research or interaction design or maybe UX writing, it's really important to just mention that somewhere in your resume as well. So it's very straight to the point. So yeah, those are my tips as well. I can mention more about it later on. Another good tip is to really know yourself as a designer. So know what your strengths and weaknesses are, what sets you apart from other people, and know your projects inside out as well, because when you do get that random screening call from a recruiter, sometimes you might be asked to jump into your portfolio during the screening interview, and then they'll just ask you to like highlight different areas of your project. And so knowing your projects inside and out is really important, and you need to be able to just like confidently talk about it without having notes and stuff like that. And I'm sure if you do your side project yourself, this should be pretty easy, but you know, just prepare just in case. Also, when you are interviewing, always ask for feedback if you can, because it's really good as a designer to be open to feedback, because you know, as a designer, it's important not to take feedback personally and to keep an open mind. And finally, having questions as well at the end. So I know it sounds obvious, but always having questions at the end really shows how passionate you are at the role. And when you don't have questions, it kind of shows that maybe you might not care about the team or the role as much. And so just prepare that as well. Okay, so moving on to the actual topic of today, take-home design challenges. So basically, usually this will come up after you've made it past the screening stage, or maybe some companies might do the technical challenge first before the screening stage. It doesn't really matter. But basically, once you're in this part of the interview, it usually means that you've done something good. And this part of the interview is just to really gauge your UX knowledge and skills. And what you can expect from take-home design challenges is you can expect to be given a design brief. And what that design brief is it usually contains the scenario that describes the problem. It might also be very specific in terms of what deliverables you need to provide by the end of it. So this, again, this depends on the role. Some roles might require, for example, if you're applying for a UX researching role, they might prefer that you just focus on the research. And so they might only ask you to provide them with really like low fidelity wireframes. However, if you're like applying for internships like me for like general UX roles, they're probably going to want like to see the entire process from start to finish. And so that means like high fidelity wireframes and a case study at the end. So an example of a case study is this one. So I actually found this on Google, and this is the case study by Google for like a UX design role, I think a couple years ago. And yeah, so basically what it is there's a couple of animals, millions of animals are waiting in foster homes. They want you to design an experience that will connect people with like a pet that's right for them. And then you also want to help potential adopters find a pet which matches their lifestyle, like that specifically focuses on these factors. So, and also, as you can see, they said that they want a high level flow and supporting wireframes. So just because they mentioned that they want this high level flow and wireframes doesn't mean that you don't have to go through the research process. You still have to go through the entire UX design process. It's just that these are the things that they probably want by the end of it as well. Yeah, and there'll be links to all of these by the end, guys, just saying. Also, you're also given like a timeline and like a recommendation. So basically, you have a certain time frame that you're meant to do the design challenge. And they also give you like a recommended time of how much you should actually spend on the challenge. So when I was doing my take-home design challenge, I actually had like 3 days over the weekend to do it. And the recommended time frame was 3 hours. And I've spoken to other people as well, and sometimes they give you a week. Some companies might give you like the recommended 5 hours to spend on a challenge. But in reality, most people who actually do these challenges spend way more time than what's recommended. And so, and that's just because of the nature of the role, right? Like it's really bad, but also like it's a lot of the times it's like the applicant's dream company. And so yes, you're going to spend more time than what you probably needed to. And also, it's just fun. Like, if you really like UX, you're just going to, like, get carried away and spend more time in it. Just make sure you don't spend too much time on it, because then it shows that you can't prioritize your time effectively. So, yeah. Cool. So also, I'm just going to look up questions really quickly before we move on.
Yeah, there's a few flux.
Okay. Yeah.
So got one here. Can you recommend some online courses to start with UX design? So from the very beginning.
Yeah. So I have a couple of course recommendations. They'll be on the resources section at the end of this. So I'll just provide, you guys can just send in the link to the notes page after this event, and all the resources are at the bottom, and there's like a starting point there as well for those of you guys who are starting out in UX.
Yep. So to everyone who's registered, I have your emails, and I'll be sending out all the resources after the event so you can see all of this.
Cool. Don't you think UX design is a very niche field, and switching on careers later to any other field in computing might be a bit difficult? I don't think UX design is very niche. I do think it's really new in the sense that UX design, as we know it now, is not, like, didn't really exist a couple of years ago. Like, it's a fast-paced field that's evolving always. So I feel like there's always going to be jobs there. However, if you're talking about switching careers from UX to another field, then it's going to be just like switching to any other career, because UX design isn't really coding related. So you're going to be switching from UX to it'll be like switching from commerce or business or marketing to a coding field, because it's not really, UX design is not really a coding field. And so it's going to be just as difficult as it is for like other careers as well. I hope that made sense. But yeah, I do think there's lots of job opportunities and growth in the future. So it's a really good field to be in right now, because it's still new and evolving. But yeah, what interviewers and hiring managers are usually looking for when they're giving you design challenges is that there's going to be 8 bullet points here, so I'm going to try and go through them as much as I can. But basically, the number one thing is, how much do you actually understand the problem? And what that means is, when you get the brief, did you try to like question it? How did you know, like, what's driving this problem? Like, did you really drill down into the core of this problem, right? How did you narrow the scope of the problem? Because obviously, as you can see from the prompt earlier, there's quite a lot of different types of people and like dogs out there. And if you keep solving for the same problem, you're going to be solving forever. And so it's good for them. So they want to see like how you actually narrow that scope of the problem into something smaller and more solvable. They also want to see like maybe what assumptions and constraints you had, how did you arrive to those, and like how you plan on maybe validating them in the future. Because in the end, you know, when you make assumptions, they're really just assumptions. Like, they're not based on anything solid. And so as a designer, you need to know how you're going to be validating like all of these educated guesses, pretty much. They also want to see like prioritization skills, like, you know, not just with time, but also with goals. So for example, when you have like lots of different goals for a specific problem, how do you decide which goal is like takes priority over the other? And you can't just say, yeah, they're the same priority. Like, you have to have like criteria to figure out which one is more important than the other. And the way you can distinguish that is, maybe you can like figure out which one has a bigger impact, or which one has like a potential like market, like something where it's not really common in the market yet, or like opportunity. So they want to see how you decide between which goals are more important over the other. They also want to see your design approach. So as you probably all know, like, UX is very user-centric, but at the same time, there's other approaches as well. For example, how do you balance engineering constraints with the actual user needs? And also, how do you balance like business goals versus the user goals? Because sometimes it can be very conflicting. Also, do you think about which people to involve at certain stages of the product? So for example, as a designer, it's not just going to be you working for the whole thing. Sometimes you might talk to like data people to like actually do the research. Sometimes you might talk to product managers who need to like set the goals with you. And also, sometimes you'll have to talk to engineering to figure out whether something's doable or whether it's not. And so it's good for them. They really want to see like these kinds of thinking and like how much you explore outside of just like design. They also want to see like how much to explore ideas. So did you consider lots of other potential solutions, or did you stick to just like one the entire time? So as a designer, it's good to be open-minded. Don't just stick to one solution. So you want to try and explore as many as you can. Also, they want to see quality of work. Like as a designer, do you have a lot of very strong attention to detail? And then also, if you're applying for UI design specifically, they want to see that you have a very strong grasp of maybe visual design principles. And they also maybe they want to see how you actually document your design, like what the specs are, like if you consider all the pixels and like how you're going to hand it over to engineering and stuff like that. Also, it's not just the work, it's also your presentation. So obviously by the end of this, you're going to want to like present this to them in like another interview. And so how are you going to tell that story? Was it very clear? And stuff like that. Second to last, your retrospective. Can you reflect on your own work? Can you see weaknesses and gaps in your current solution? And how are you going to account for those? And how are you going to approach them in the future? And lastly, openness to feedback. This more applies to like when you actually present your work. So basically don't get defensive if the interviewers kind of like start questioning you and grilling you during your presentation. Just acknowledge them. And if you have like a potential approach to like something that they said, just mention it. But basically don't ever take feedback personally. Just take it as constructive criticism about your work, and it's not about you personally. Cool, so before I move on to like a sample design challenge, I'm just gonna see if there's any more questions. So should I add everything in my portfolio that I've designed in the past or just the good projects? So basically, if you're applying for UX roles, I would focus on the case studies. So by case studies, what I mean is something where you have a problem and then you go through the entire research, ideation, exploration, refining, and prototyping process and testing. It's not so much focused on all the visual stuff like logos, and flyers and stuff like that. So if that is mostly what your portfolio is about, I would encourage you to write up like a case study of like why you picked certain colors, like what it means for the brand and stuff like that. But just images by themselves, I wouldn't say is enough for like a UX role. So you need to actually like show evidence of like design thinking and going through that process from start to finish. I hope that helps. So yeah. Just really quickly, I can't actually reveal you guys my full design challenge just out of respect for the company that I was hiring, that I was applying to. But there are a lot of other designers all over the world who have made the designs public. So I'm assuming they got approval to share that. And so I'm going to share that. I'm going to walk through one of them with you guys. But in the meantime, you can see like my demo is on the left of like my final high fidelity wireframe and prototype. All right, so if you guys want to follow along, this is like the first one that I have for you, probably the only one that we'll be able to go through. But basically what happened was this person just wrote a blog which details all of their case studies, right? And so this is the same prompt that you got earlier, and it's all about like pets and owners and trying to match owners with the right pets and trying to find the right owners for every pet that is out there. And so as you can see in the case study, they started off with like the final solution, just to kind of like give you a teaser of what's there to come. But obviously, like I said earlier, it's not just about the visuals. You have to also show your entire process. And so as you can see, what this person did is they started with pen and paper and they started looking at the different goals. They started brainstorming ideas, what kind of issues there are and pain points kind of. And like also another interesting thing this person looked at is how they can integrate this app into like Google's services at the moment. And so this is really important because he was applying to Google and it shows that he was thinking about the company as well and not just like the app by itself. So this is really cool. Here's when the user's talking about the problem. You guys feel free to read this at the end. The link is right here. All the links will be in the resources section as well. So you can read all of these in your own time. And then you can also see a couple of initial sketches and wireframes and how they're going to look, which is really always interesting to see. And yeah, these ones are like more low fidelity wireframes. And just explaining it. And this is like shows you as well, like all the different explorations this person went through. As you can see, what was in the sketches is not necessarily what was in the final solution. And so as a hiring manager, you're probably going to want to see whether this person actually considered lots of different ideas before like settling on like one final one. It's a really interesting read, actually, guys. So I really recommend reading this whole thing. It's really smart. It's really cool. So, yeah. And then just by the end of it, to wrap it up, he's just showcasing like the final look of the app and walking through the different features he's implemented and why and how they come to be there. So it's just like a case study, like we talked about last week, except it's probably going to be a lot less. There's going to be less steps. It's not going to be as in depth, just because you have like less of a time to work on this compared to your other projects. Yeah, and then towards the end, he also talked about like reflection. So his reflection is pretty much talking about the next steps of the app. So in his case, he was considering how to integrate this app with Google services. And I think it's really cool that he really went that extra mile to consider how it's going to work with Chromecast, for example. So yeah, there's actually two other case studies, but just because of time, we probably won't go through them. However, they're very similar. One of the guys actually worked on the same prompt. So if you're very interested, the links are on the screen right now. And they'll also be on the resources, so feel free to check it out in your own time. Yeah, just gonna close this one. Cool. So now you guys are probably asking, how do we actually tackle these design challenges? But just before we move on, I wanted to make sure nobody has questions. Yep, sounds good. All right, so when you guys are tackling these challenges, there's like certain frameworks that you can follow. For example, first of all, what is the framework? For those of you guys who are not sure, framework is basically just like, it just describes your approach to something. One example of like an approach to UX design is Dan Nessler's double diamond framework, which you can see on the left here. I've also added the link to that in the resources section. But basically, it's not that complicated. If you actually break down this image on the left, you'll see that it's very simple and straightforward. UX design is just like these four different parts, right? Your research, your analysis, ideation, and your implementation. And then within all of those steps, you have multiple steps in the middle of how you can approach them. But other than that, pretty much UX design is just, this is pretty much what a framework is. It just describes your approach. So I'm going to be talking to you guys about like my personal approach and to design challenges. Just like a word of warning, I guess, you know, there's no such thing as like a one size fits all framework. I still recommend you consider the problem and solve it as you see is appropriate. So, but if you're a new designer, this is definitely like a good way that you can start. And then as you kind of like get more experience, you can figure out what framework works best for you. All right, so before we actually get started on like the design activity, I just wanted to give you a really high level overview of the framework and then get in more in depth with it later. So basically what my framework is really simple. First of all, define your problem. Always try to understand the problem first, you know, like never ever jump straight into like the solution. So basically narrow your scope, set some goals, state your assumptions straight off the bat, get some constraints. And yeah, I think that's pretty much it for my, like the start of my framework. Second part is kind of do your research. So try to understand if there's any existing solutions. This is where you also try to understand your users a bit more. And then also see if there's already an existing flow for the specific problem. I mean, there's already an existing, like what the existing flow is for the current solution. And then try and identify gaps there and opportunities so you can improve on the user experience. So this is the part where you might be making a personas, something like this, really simple. Or it could be the part where you're drawing out your user flows and journey maps and stuff like that. Next part is your ideation and your exploration phase. I can't talk. This is where you would like brainstorm just as much as you want. Like yourself, this is the part where you just let yourself go crazy, like brainstorm as many solutions as you want, but within your constraints. So always remember your constraints and then try and prioritize which solutions is better and try and decide which one's better based on like your prioritization methods. So this is when you set criteria, like which one do you really want to go for? And later we can work on that in the activity. So this is an example of like when you might be doing brainstorming. This is like a technique called Crazy Eight, where you like split your paper into like 8 different boxes, and then you just try and make 8 different solutions. And then based on like which one you think is better, you go for it. And we're going to be doing something like this later. And then lastly, you would want to, like, the last section, actually, the second last section in my framework is, like, your refinement. This is when you make final changes based on your testing notes. So before you actually get to here, you try and evaluate your design. And then depending on what you see could be improved, you make those final changes, and then make sure if it is needed, make sure you get your high fidelity prototypes as well. Something like this. So this could probably, if you're applying for internships, like general UX internships, this is probably something that would be expected of you by the end of the challenge. Also in your reflection, lastly, don't forget that reflection and retrospective bit. Always acknowledge what would you do differently? What do you wish you had more time? What do you wish you had more time to do? What would you do if you had more resources? And lastly, is there any other next steps that you can think of for your specific project? All right, so that was a really high-level overview. Before we actually go more in-depth to that, I just wanted to mention how we're going to start the collaborative design activity right now. What we'll be doing is we'll be working together to solve a design challenge on Miro. So if you guys are on your laptops, like, please open this link now. I'll be talking you guys through it later. But basically, I'll be revealing a prompt in a second, and then we'll be trying, like, to solve that prompt using the frameworks that I just mentioned earlier. So basically, I've split the frameworks into 5 different sections, and I'll be going through each of them in more depth. And every section we'll be trying to apply those and work together on Miro. And yeah, for the rest of the session, that's what we'll be doing. So hopefully get Miro ready. The link is up on there. So yeah, also grab a piece of pen and paper if you do have one. Cool. So now, while you guys are doing that, I just wanted to introduce the prompt really quickly. The prompt for this session will be, destruction is everywhere. Basically, we're always fighting destructions and procrastinations when we're trying to get work done using our digital devices. And the challenge is, can you design an environment to help people focus on their work? So I picked this prompt because I feel like everyone can relate to this. And the thing about design challenges is it's really hard to do user research. And so if you can like put yourself in the place of like the user of the problem that you're trying to solve, then it's going to be a lot easier, especially for new designers as well. So if you guys do have pen and paper, the reason I'm showing this prompt now is to like give you maybe 30 seconds to gather your thoughts and get your initial thoughts on like this problem and how you think you can approach it. Like, no pressure, just 30 seconds, think about it. Feel free to type in the chat if you have thoughts, but if not, then that's okay as well. I don't know if this helps, but I have gone ahead and get your sticky notes, whatever else you want. Okay, hopefully that was enough time to like let you guys get your initial thoughts. So don't feel pressured to like narrow this down already. It's just like kind of letting the prompt sink in and trying to like get a feel for it in the beginning. And so usually when I get a prompt like this and I'm looking at it in the very beginning, what I would do is just like highlight certain keywords that I think is really important and I should focus on. And in this case, what I found was distractions, procrastinations, digital devices, and then finally the actual task itself, which is to design an environment that will help people focus better. And if you want to narrow that down even more, the keywords I would say is distractions, devices, and designing an environment. So hopefully you guys got something similar. And if you didn't, then that'd be really interesting to see what you did when we do get to the Miro board stage. Yep. But before we do jump onto the Miro board, I just wanted to explain a bit in a bit more depth the first stage of the framework, and then we'll try and apply that on Miro. So basically, the first thing we got to do is understand this problem. So first of all, just ask yourself maybe like, so why is this actually a problem, right? So how did this, like, how did this actually happen in the first place? Also, this is also a good time to like figure out what is the requirements of this challenge. So in some briefs, like for the one earlier, for example, they were asking for high fidelity wireframes, but it's also good to look beyond that. And like, it's more like the requirement of the users involved in the problem. Also, we have to narrow the scope a little bit because it's like at the moment, it's a pretty big elaborate problem, right? So they're just talking about people, but like who actually are these people that we're designing for? And so if we're trying to design for everyone in the world, we're never going to finish. And so really good to just narrow down that scope a little bit. Also maybe talk about constraints as well. And then thirdly, I would set some goals before we start solving this problem. Like for example, how do we know like that this problem is solved? Like what is our success criteria? Also, what is the overall goal of the project? And stuff like that. Also, we're probably gonna have multiple goals. So it's good to kind of like start thinking about how are we gonna decide which goal is more important and which ones do we like prioritize over the other. Lastly, we should also think about some assumptions and constraints and be upfront with them right from the get-go. Now, obviously we can't think of all the assumptions like right from the beginning. And so it's good to kind of like keep track of your assumptions as you go throughout the project and just like list them down some way. If you're working on a piece of paper, maybe grab some sticky notes and just like stick them to your wall and you can look at it whenever you feel like doing that. So, yeah. So cool. Now we'll be jumping onto Miro and trying to apply this first stage. So is everyone, just give me a yes in the chat if you have Miro open, and I'll be going onto there in just 2 seconds. But before that, I'll just answer some questions while you guys are going to Miro.
Yeah, there's a lot of people on the Miro board and they're getting started on it. So.
I've got
some stuff already.
Yeah.
Wait, I think my computer is lagging. I can't close. Look.
It's okay.
But yeah, so just to start with, guys, it's really cool to see that you guys have put in so much, but please don't go to the research yet because we haven't covered that. So we'll start with the, on the left-hand side, you'll see something called Define, and this is what like the first framework is really talking about. So as you guys can see, I'll walk you through what the board is doing. And so the white thing at the very top here, which says define the problem, that's just kind of like a card to remind you what this stage is all about. So hopefully we'll spend 10 minutes on this. And then if you scroll down to the bottom a little bit, you'll see kind of like the questions that I was asking. For example, what is the problem and what is driving it? And also what are the requirements of this problem? And also underneath that, I've written the words in blue on like which specific parts of the original prompt might help you to kind of like figure out what is the real, to like answer this question. So for example, like what is in the first ticket here, like what is the problem and what is driving it? I wrote down distractions. And I feel like that's because this is really the core of the problem, right? So we're procrastinating because we're distracted. And now it's kind of all about like, why are we really distracted? So if everyone can like unmute and let's talk about like what you guys wrote, that'd be really cool. But yeah, these are some really good ideas, guys. Let's do this maybe for 2 minutes and like I'll let everyone add their thoughts and then we can like walk through it. Yep, 2 minutes. Start now. Also, just to help you guys, I'll be talking as well. So basically, when I see this problem, I'm starting to think, okay, so what are some distractions that people are usually getting? Wait, actually, before I move on to there, I want to look at the users first. So for example, who is having this problem? In the prompt, they really only mention people. However, there's a lot of different types of people, right? Like when looking at this, I'm thinking, okay, are we talking about office workers who are like, are they usually distracted? Or maybe I'm talking about uni students and like, what is it about uni students that makes them really distracted? And I'm sure you guys can talk a lot about this. Or maybe if not uni students, maybe you want to focus on like high school students and like why they're distracted. And they might seem very similar, but it's really important to make that distinction just because I feel like uni students and high school students and even primary school students have like different like things that distract them, like at their point in life. So yeah, or we could be trying to think of other different types of people here. Yeah, people with like a disability or something like that. Yeah, that's really cool. Stay at home moms and dads. That's very specific, but I like it. People working from home. Yep, that's really cool. Yeah. And also talking about goals, helping people focus is really the key word. That's in the problem that really talks about this. And I'm thinking, yeah, this is really good. So how do you know that people are focused, right? And so this is really user specific. If they're a student, then you probably know that they're being productive by the length of time that it takes them to finish maybe an assignment. So, or maybe the length of time it takes them to finish a lecture. So I don't know about you guys, but when I'm watching lectures, I stop halfway or maybe like after 5 minutes and then I get distracted and watch a YouTube video and then I come back to it. And so as you can see, if you're looking at the different stages of the process, you can quickly see that there's lots of different things that you can measure. Also, a good note about the goals is it's good to set like measurable goals. So for example, increasing productivity is pretty hard to measure, right? This is something that's very qualitative, like it's very subjective, right? So some people might say, yeah, I feel like I'm productive today, but how do you actually know that you're more productive? So there's a lot of different apps that track your specific usages of like which apps you're using at a specific point in time. So there you can clearly see how often you're using certain apps. And so with that one, there's like an actual number tied to it. In certain cases, it's more like assignments. So if we're actually designing for a student, then you can see that someone succeeded if they can finish like a certain assignment or a lecture in like a shorter amount of time. And maybe we can start with something like, oh yeah, I just want to finish my assignments in like 20% less than what I did before, something like that. So that's kind of like what I'm thinking about when I'm looking at goals. Also, let's look at scope. Scope is really good. I think it's quite scalable. Yep, that's definitely true. I agree with that. That's pretty good. So the scope, when I'm saying people as well here, is kind of like, yeah, so you're designing for a certain type of people. When you're designing for just a student, for example, what other types of people can you reach with that potentially after the project is finished? Also digital devices, want to limit the scope here as well, because as I can see already, there's so many different devices people have put in, like laptops, tablets, smart TVs, smart watches, and there's really no way to kind of like design an environment that encompasses all of these devices, because then you're just going to be like designing forever. And so what we're going to do is probably kind of remove some of these and like really narrow down the scope into like specific devices. And the way we're going to figure that out is by looking at the users again, like which is the most impactful to the user. Okay, so now that we've got that, just moving back to the top on what is actually driving the problem. Yeah, social media is pretty big. Again, it's dependent on the user. Like if you're at work and you're like someone who's 40 years old, you're probably not as distracted by social media as someone who is a bit younger. So these are, there's lots of different interesting considerations. And I hope that you guys are starting to see like why the user really matters a lot. Yep, cool. Also, when someone says design an environment, so what are the requirements of this prompt? Like what does the environment actually mean, right? So are we talking about the specific device environment? Like for example, are we talking about the environment just from like limited to the actual laptop or like the computer itself? Or are we talking more about like a physical environment? Like for example, are you designing like a physical space that people can go to be distraction free? So sometimes the solution is not always digital, and it's just good to consider if there's any physical things that you can do as well, like in the real world. Also, AR and VR is pretty interesting to put in there as well, because like it's kind of like a mixed reality thing where your environment, you're in a digital kind of environment, but at the same time, because it's virtual reality, it's kind of like simulates your physical environment. So there's lots of cool things that we can consider here. Also, I love how everyone's going to research. That's very cool. So yeah. Okay, so 2 minutes is up for like a very long time. So just looking at these frameworks, gonna ask everyone's thoughts. Just grab like on the left hand side, you'll see like a pencil like icon. So if you want to just like start crossing out some stuff and circling stuff based on priority, then that'd be really cool. But first of all, we'll start with like the people. Can everyone just like write in the chat like who you want to design for out of all of these things that are here? And then we can just like decide on that and use that now. Okay, yeah, so someone circled university students, which is perfect, because I was actually thinking that because everyone here is already a student, we will be able to draw out all the different flows a lot easier. So we're just gonna go ahead and cross out everything. And in your case study, when you do decide to kind of like mention why you picked university students, your reasoning can just be like, yeah, I didn't have access to much research, and so I wanted to like narrow down the users into something that was more relatable to me. And so I'll be able to like empathize with their situations a lot more. And I have like, I know a lot of people as well who fit into this criteria, and you'll be able to conduct like better, you'll be able to gather better data. So it's really as simple as that, like justifying why you fix certain things. Because April, we're gonna have to like ignore your response there because everyone here likes students, so yeah.
I'm just saying working from home
is hard. Yeah, it is. I'm working from home right now, and it's like I'm always distracted. Yeah. Like, I do my work.
Yeah.
So, like, but, you know, you got to listen to the people, and since everyone wants university students, we're going to do that. All right. So looking at, since we speak university students, just going back up to the goal, what is really driving the problem? Like, why are university students distracted? So we're just going to go ahead and cross out the stuff that's not relevant to university students. And if you are a university student, like add more tickets or like sticky notes there, which talk about your distractions as a university student. Okay, I'm not gonna add any stuff, but I trust you guys. So, is the stimulation dependent on always being stimulated? Yeah, I guess that's fair. So that's definitely me, because I feel like I always have to be doing something. I'm not sure if this is representative of most students though. So what I would do is I would put an asterisk here and just say something like, I would need to validate this later on when I conduct user interviews. So that's a very interesting thing right there to say. Getting texts and calls, I feel like you can put that under maybe social media or talking to other people, something like that. Boring material, yeah, definitely. Random dog videos, that's cute. But I think that definitely goes into social media. So. Just looking at all of these, what you would do now at this stage is kind of like rank like these distractions. It just kind of helps you later on focus on like which flow to narrow down on, but I'm guessing short attention span and social media would be like the two biggest factors. But obviously what I would do is actually put some criteria or maybe conduct, I would rank, give them like a kind of initial ranking, and then later on when I do user interviews, I'll kind of ask people, and then from what they tell me, I'll be able to get a proper ranking of which is actually more important or which is the bigger cause. So hopefully that's informative to you guys, but I don't know. Very nice drawing. Cool. And then design an environment. At the moment, we're not going to design something physical just because we want something tangible for the end of this result. And so we're going to cross out anything there that says physical. And so I guess when we're talking about the environment, there's some really cool ideas there. I think what we're talking about is just the immediate environment. Like for example, what are the devices that are closest to these people that kind of, that is mix up their environment. So for example, as a student, it's very likely that what you'll be working on the most is your laptop, your phone and tablet. So this is kind of like what makes up your environment pretty much. So. Obviously, we're going to have to mention as well, like the assumptions that there's nothing else in the environment that's going to be distracting them. And so we're going to assume that maybe TVs, smartwatches and other stuff like that isn't a distraction. I know it's a pretty big assumption to make and it's pretty flawed, but just going to have to limit ourselves here. So yeah, I guess everyone's starting to see like the approach that I'm taking. I'll leave you guys to fill in the rest of the form, but just for the time's sake, we're going to go to the, I'm going to keep going with the presentation. I just want to talk about the next step in the framework. The next step is actually research. This is the time where you kind of look up, this is when you do your competitive research, you know, so you kind of see, is there existing solutions already? What are their strengths and weaknesses and stuff like that? What are their biggest selling points? Also, you want to conduct user research. This is when you'd probably want to talk to your users and understand, you know, how they're feeling, what their goals are. For example, try to basically just empathize with them and understand, you know, what their context is, what their story is, goals, needs, thoughts, feelings, pain points, and stuff like that. So you're probably going to make a persona or a journey map at some point this stage. Oh, yeah. That's what I thought I was going to talk about. This is when you probably want to talk about your personas. So initially we made like pretty big assumptions on our users. So when you do user research, this is like your time to actually put those goals and persona and like the background of your user into like concrete, like list them out on a piece of paper in a way that you can understand. So revise the goals that you gave them, you know, talk about the story, like what's their background. For example, as a university student, you know, this person gets distracted really easily. Because like they do the subject which they really hate or something like that. I don't know. So just talk about that a little bit more. And then lastly, you want to map out like a user journey as well. This is when you take into account if there's like a like an already existing flow. So for example, what is the current like flow of tasks that users are doing, which leads them to being distracted? And then once you map that out, like what usually happens, like every step of the way, you can kind of identify like gaps and pain points and opportunities to kind of like improve the user experience. So it would be really cool to like look into this and see the map, how the map looks like later. Also, this is when you kind of pick one flow to focus on because you're obviously design challenged, you don't have very much time. So this is when prioritization is going to be super important and you just pick one flow to design for and stick to that for the rest of the challenge. Also consider edge cases, probably something you can also consider in your reflection. Yep, so I'm sure people have already started researching, but go again to the Miro board and then let's start filling in the research section. So I'll set another 2-minute timer and then I'll start talking again. 2-minute timer. It'll be really interesting to see what you guys have come up with, and then I'll walk you through like kind of like my thought process as well. Cool, yeah. Really interesting to see. So basically, for the top bit, this is where the existing solutions. So if you guys are using productivity apps like Pomodoro's, Forest, or whatever else, it'd be cool to just write them down. And if you want to copy and paste pictures from Google somewhere here, that'd be really cool. Like, it's actually really easy to copy paste images of Miro if you want to paste that in the images section. Also, strengths, districts, app usage, yep, weaknesses, and selling points. Also, on the right-hand side here is where we try to, like, understand our users. So normally we would kind of, like, maybe you would probably ask your friends to do, like, a 10-minute user interview, and then you might also maybe make surveys to, like, send out to a couple of your friends, but because we don't have time for that, we're just going to kind of fill these in and make assumptions on what we think like all of these different things are about the user. So feel free to do that as well on top of the competitive research. So it looks like time is up. We'll just walk through some of these ideas really quickly. Oh my god, I just got it. Yeah. That's very cool. I'll help you out. Yep, cool. So basically looking at some of the ideas people have, this is really cool for us. Social media extension app blockers that are extensions, Pomodoros. Yep, do not disturb. Yep, cool. Yep, if we had time to do user interviews, it'd also be cool to like kind of ask them how effective like all of these things are, you know, for example, how productive do they think they've been since starting using these apps and stuff like that. It's also interesting to see if there were any challenges with learning how to use these apps, because I know definitely some people kind of like, they use this app and then it doesn't work for them and it takes like a very long time to like actually work. And so it'd be interesting to see stuff like that. But other than that, I think there's some really good strengths, weaknesses, and selling points here. So yeah, actually, I think the selling points for those of you who do use Forest, I think the biggest selling point with Forest is that it really reaches out to the user. For example, I don't know much about it, but I think they donate or like they plant trees depending on how often you study. And so that kind of like is an extra incentive for those people who do care a lot about like the environment and like stuff like that. And so that's another selling point there that we might not be able to provide, but we can definitely think of something to kind of like challenge that. All right, so just moving on to like the demographic. Obviously what we're designing for is university students, right? So when you're gonna be doing your user interviews, it'll be good to ask them, you know, how old they actually are, what they study, because there might be interesting patterns. Like for example, IT students probably don't have to study as much as like other people in degree. Why did I say that? It's like we have more practical stuff compared to other degrees, which are more heavy on like reading. So there's lots of interesting differences in the way that people study. So it's good to note that as well. Also their experience, like whether they're a Jesse or if they're a bit more experienced in uni, because I know when I was like first year, I had trouble concentrating, but like now it's a bit better. So those are the kind of things you might want to consider for demographic. Also the level of interest in the actual course, because I know that people who are just not interested at all have a hard time focusing in. So it'd be really cool to understand people's experiences. Also in terms of user goals, really it depends on the user, it depends on your user interviews. But when I say goals, it's not stuff like get a high grade or maybe get an HD and stuff like that. Goals is not something that the user wants to achieve, like overall, like in their life. Like what is the point of them? Like what are they actually trying to gain in life? For example, do they want to get a high paying job or do they want to get an internship? Or maybe do they just want to get kind of like get started and get like their toes in the water or something like that. And then once you have that kind of goal, and then that's when you outline like all the different tasks they want to do to get to that goal. So for example, maybe one pathway for them to get to like the career they want is to actually get really high grades, because that specific industry wants really high grades. So that's when you that's what you write in the tasks. Other things I can think of is like maybe doing lots of different side projects. For example, definitely in UX, all of your side projects is pretty much all that counts. They probably don't look at your grades as much as the side projects that you do. And so that could be an example of a task. And you can also break those tasks down into even smaller tasks. So for example, in the side project, you probably gonna wanna do like research or prototyping and stuff like that. Motivations, this is gonna depend on specific people. Like this is kind of like why they want that specific goal, right? So some people have like families who they want to provide for. Some people just like what really drives them is like they just want to feel satisfied in their life. And for some people, it's their career that makes them satisfied. And so maybe that's why they have that goal. Or maybe some people really just care about the money. So lots of interesting things here to consider. But obviously, it's your user interviews and surveys that are going to help you narrow this down. Yep, also frustrations. Obviously, frustrations is getting distracted when you're trying to do work, like we were talking about. It's also good to narrow down. So some of the things that we found out here in the problem can definitely apply to frustration. So for example, someone always gets distracted on social media, or someone like always loses interest halfway through like a project and then they just stop it and then they never finish everything. So stuff like that. Yeah, so basically frustrations. Just look at every task they have and then maybe consider what things, like what kind of pain points do they have at like all the tasks that they're trying to do to get to their goal. And finally, devices used. Like not all personas have devices used, and the only reason I put that here is because it's very relevant to the prompt. Like I said earlier, with like the environment, we can't design for all environments, and so it's really good to just narrow that down to the devices that are going to be most used. And I think for us, we're going to focus more on like laptop and mobile phones. But definitely you can consider iPads and stuff like that if you were to do this in your own time and you had like more time to kind of like work through it. But yeah, that's a lot of really cool ideas, guys. Thank you so much for adding that. Just going to check the box to see if anyone has any questions. Oh, wait, yeah, sorry. I forgot to mention like the current flow as well. I'm not sure if we have time to do this, but basically what this would be is just something I forgot to look at. Yeah. Basically what the flow would be is just like an example of a user trying to do a task and then getting distracted somewhere in the middle. So for example, at every stage of that flow, you want to consider what are they doing? And then for every action that they're doing, you want to consider, okay, what are they actually feeling at this point in time? Like, are they stressed? Are they worried? You also want to consider, like, what they're thinking in their head, like whether, oh, I'm so bored, I don't want to do this anymore, or I'm almost about to give up, something like that. Also, what are they saying? This might not be as relevant, especially if you're studying quietly. So not all of these is going to be relevant, but it's good to have anyway to try and empathize with the user. Also, there'll be pain points and gain points. And what that is at every step that we've identified the users are going to be doing, is there like a pain point there that people are experiencing that we can probably try and fix? And then gain points is kind of like, is there anything here that the user can gain or something that we can do to like make a life better for them, pretty much. So for example, if someone was like maybe watching a lecture, the different steps that the user is probably doing for this specific flow, I'm gonna just write this one, watching a lecture, just because it's really simple. So what are the different steps involved in watching a lecture? So this is gonna sound kind of like pretty dumb, but we need to actually break it down into the different steps. So, and that starts from like, maybe, I don't know, going to uni, actually not, because we're remote, people will just be grabbing the device. So the step one would be grab a device that you're gonna watch your lecture in. And then the second step would be maybe, I don't know, going to Moodle to find a lecture. And then the third step would be actually trying to find that lecture through all of the subjects that you have. Wait, also, can someone write this down, please? I don't know if anyone's ready.
Yep, I can write it. I'm pretty lucky.
Okay.
But I'll try it. Whereabouts? Do you want to
start? Good. Oh, good. Basically, so the first step doing is kind of like, so we're doing the flow for watching a lecture. So the first thing would be, first step would be grabbing a device that you're going to watch the lecture in. And then second step would be going onto Moodle and going into the specific unit that you're going to watch the lecture in. Can you put them in, we'll put them in the separate boxes as well.
Yeah. Because
like, we're going to have to describe stuff. That's okay. And then after that, they're going to be probably finding the lecture in the specific unit section, because you know how in Moodle there's a unit and then you have to find your lecture somewhere there. What else? After that, once you find your lecture, you open up the lecture and then you start watching it. I think we'll leave it at that. Obviously, there's more stages, but I think this is just a good starting point just to show you guys like my thought process. But basically, straight off the bat, once you're opening, like once you're grabbing your device to, opening your assignment sheet, once you're like grabbing your device to watch the lecture, like what are you feeling at this stage? So if we're going to assume that the persona is very disinterested, they could be feeling like something like dread, like, oh, I don't want to watch this lecture, it's so boring, I don't want to see it anymore. That could be what they're feeling. And also, so the pain point there, at the moment, I think the pain point here is really dependent on what the device is. You want to narrow down, like, are they watching on their laptops or are they watching on mobile? So if they're watching on mobile, there's a very big pain point there that, like, because it's so unusable on mobile, that you're more likely to get distracted. And so that's one pain point, and that's, like, a potential gain point that we can help users with as well. And the second step is, let's move on to the third step, actually, because it's very interesting, where it says you actually, so the step where you have to actually find your lecture on Moodle, this is another very painful process. So what you're probably feeling here is you're probably feeling very frustrated. Like, it's like you can't find your lecture at any point, because I know this definitely has happened to me. Like, because it's so hard to find a lecture, you can feel a little bit demotivated to watch it, and that's when you might start getting distracted. What you're thinking, you could be thinking like, oh, I feel like this is such a waste of time. I could be doing something else better, like watching YouTube or finishing like the last episode of whatever series you're watching. So these are some of the things that you could be thinking about while you're trying, while you're spending 10 minutes trying to find a lecture. Again, pain point there is very frustrating. And so if there's like something there that we can help them to like stop getting distracted, that's a really interesting thing to bring up. But yeah, that's like how I would start mapping out the current flow. But as you guys can see, it's just like really breaking down each of the individual steps of like a certain process. And then really considering what they're doing, what they're feeling, thinking, saying, and any of the pain points there, and anything and any opportunities that maybe we can do to kind of like help them. So in games, what I would write here is like how we can actually maybe solve the problem of feeling frustrated or feeling like they don't want to do Moodle and something like that. But unfortunately, I'm going to have to move on to, so we can cover the rest of it. But hopefully that has showed you guys the importance of like mapping out the flows for the different tasks. So yeah, after that step, once you've mapped out your flows, you'll go to the ideation and exploration process. And all this is that's when you start brainstorming and like trying to find out as many solutions as you can. And then after that, you kind of like pick the preferred solutions. Again, prioritization comes in here. So out of all the solutions that you've gotten in your brainstorm, like which one do you think will work the best and have the most impact on the user? And the way you decide this is you go back into your persona, you go back into your flow that you mapped out and see which one like is going to benefit them the most. And then this is also when you want to make your wireframes and your prototypes. You know, depending on the role that you apply for, again, the level of depth here is really dependent on that. And lastly, you also want to evaluate your solution. So once you do have a prototype working, you won't have enough time to conduct proper tests, but you should be able to kind of like make some basic evaluations. Like for example, like how much is this solution that I have right now going to help the user? Like how big is the impact? Or maybe you just want to also evaluate the general usability heuristics. Like you want to use Nielsen's usability heuristics to kind of just like evaluate whether your solution is actually usable and whether it's easy to use. So you also want to look at your components individually and see like which one is actually useful and which one's like something that you can take away. So yeah, that's the ideation exploration. Like we won't be able to do this whole thing for this workshop. However, we will be focusing on the brainstorming phase. What we'll be doing in the next 5 minutes is using the Crazy 8 design method. And I kind of touched up upon this earlier, but basically what this is you grab a piece of paper, you split your paper into 8 sections, and then you spend 1 minute on each section, and then you kind of like try and design a different solution for each of the boxes or sections that you have on your piece of paper. Like, however, because we only have 5 minutes, we're just gonna like try and make 3 different solutions, and then we'll be uploading them to Cutly/UploadDesign2020, and then we'll try and compare everyone's solutions to this problem. Yeah.
All right, what are the 3 sections?
Oh no, it's up to you. So just split into 3 sections. And the idea is you draw a different solution to the problem in each of those different sections.
Okay, so this is like the final proposed solution.
Not the final, it's like brainstorming.
Okay, cool.
Yeah. So this is like a brainstorming method that people usually do. You just kind of spend 1 minute on something and then you draw. And you try and make it different from like the last thing that you drew, and you spend maybe 1 minute on each section, and then just figure out whatever comes to your mind. And there's no limits other than the constraints and the scope that we set out in the initial part of the workshop. Okay, well, that was the last minute up. I hope you guys got some really cool ideas. But basically, that's going to be the end of the kind of brainstorming session. If you guys did have like a lot of cool drawings, it'd be really cool if you can upload them to this link right here. It's just a Google Photos link, like it's a Google Photos album. So if you can just take a photo of it with your phone at any point, maybe right now or later on, and then you can upload it to that specific link there. And then it'd be really cool to see what everyone's come up with. But basically, that is pretty much the like the brainstorming part of the ideation and exploration phase. Like if you explored a lot of really cool ideas, that's very helpful because that's definitely what the hiring manager would look for. However, once you do have lots of different ideas, that's when you would probably want to start selecting the solution that you're going to go for. So out of all the ideas you have, you're probably going to want to prioritize which one's going to be the most impactful to your users and then stick with that one. And then once you've got that, you start mapping your wireframes and like the flows of the actual different screens that you're going to have. If it's an app or if it's like a desktop app or whatever it is, this would be a good time to really like get in depth to it and get all of your high fidelity wireframes done. Now, once you do have like a prototype, the last stage in the framework is refining it. And what that is doing is what you would do is just kind of evaluate each and every component that is in your solution and evaluate whether it is necessary and it's adding value. And if it's not, then just get rid of it completely. Or if there's like a way that you can like improve on it, then this would be a good time to do that. And lastly, once you've identified these, you make your final changes and stuff like that. Just to give you guys an example, I have like a wireframe here, like of what a project I made before. And basically this is just a screen. It's like a quiz app for like a mobile, it's a quiz app for mobiles. And just looking at this screen, if you're gonna do your evaluation, I'd be asking myself, oh, do I really need that icon there? Do I really need this highlight there? What's the point of having that small dashed line? Like, isn't it enough to kind of like separate like this height of the text and like the weight and stuff like that? And also once I move on to it, I would also ask myself, okay, so why did you put the actual percentage number there? Like, isn't the bar enough to kind of like tell the users like at which point of the quiz they are? So just like the stuff that I would be asking. It's really evaluating every single thing on the screen and identifying if it's useful or if you can improve on it and stuff like that. And yeah, so I'm trying to find if there's another one. Cool. So yeah, I'd also be looking at the interactions as well. So when I first made this, actually, you might notice that when I click on it, there's like a short animation. So when I made this the first time, it was really flat. There was no animation there. And I was thinking, oh, like how does the user know that they've actually clicked something, right? And so that's when I decided to add the animations last minute. So this is kind of like what the refining section is for. It's like you really looking at the final details, like the smallest details at every part of your screen and seeing if there's anything you can add or if there's anything that you can change. Yeah, that's pretty much it for the refining section. And we're almost done. Once you're done with your refining section, that's when you reflect on your project. What would you do differently if you had more time or if you had more resources? So for example, if you had a whole team of designers, what are some really cool things that you found? Or like maybe you had like cool brainstorming, maybe you had a cool idea from your brainstorming phase that you couldn't really like flesh out because you didn't have access to like all the time and resources. So this would be a good time for you to like talk about that and say what you would do hypothetically if you did have time. Also, what other parts would you explore? For example, it's good to like talk about the other ideas you had as well, because it shows the hiring managers that, yeah, it's not that you skipped them for no reason. It's that you thought of them, but you just didn't go through them in more depth because you didn't have enough time and stuff like that. And so if you did have the time, what other parts and like ideas would you explore that you think would benefit the user? You can also consider what's next for the project. If you feel like the challenge you were given is something that could be taken to market, what are the things that you would probably do to make that happen? And lastly, the most important thing is if you're a student, it's also good to state what you learned. For example, when I was doing my design challenge, I had to design for an existing product, and I had never designed for an existing product before. Like all of my side projects were just stuff that I did randomly from scratch. And so like designing for an existing product had its own challenges. And so if you did learn something new, if there's lots of things that you learned, definitely write that down in your reflection as well. Because it's good to see that you're passionate about learning and that you're open to learning new things. Yeah, so that's pretty much the end of the framework. Once you are done, once you've completed the challenge, there's only one last step that you need to do, and that is presenting your work. Usually, you'll be invited again to a follow-up interview to kind of like present your work to like the hiring managers. So don't forget to prepare a slide deck. Don't forget to prepare a case study as well to send to them beforehand. And once you do go to that interview, make sure you're prepared because they will grill you a little bit. They'll keep asking you, like, oh, why did you do that? Like, for example, just going back to the flow that I was showing you guys, they'll be asking you, oh, okay, so why did you pick this font? Like, why did you have emojis? Why did you use, like, this specific line thickness? Why a specific color? Just stuff like that. And it's good to just, like, be conscious of the design decisions you're making throughout the journey. So in my specific case, I picked this specific color because it was part of the branding for what I was designing it for. And then I picked a specific background because it provided like enough contrast to be accessible to like different people that were using it. And there's like a number of like the contrast for accessibility, but I can't remember. And so if you are going to your interview, it might be good to just get those numbers or whatever else helps you justify all the design decisions you put into your final solution. So yeah, if you want to see the, and there's like a template as well, which you can use when you're presenting your final work, and that is this one right here. I will zoom into this. I won't go into too much detail. I didn't make this. Someone else made this, so credit to them. But it can be as simple as something like this. So it's pretty much summarizing all the different research that you've done, like we were doing earlier, and then all the different iterations that you went through, all the wireframes, and finally, like just presenting your final solution as well. So this will all be in the resources towards the end, but also the link is right there if you need it. And yeah, that is pretty much the end of today's session. If you guys do have questions, please post them onto Flux right now, and I'll be having a look at it in a second towards the end after I say some final things. I'm also basically outside of this workshop, I'm also helping students kind of like personally and giving one-on-one advice. So it's part of this initiative called MacX Career Prep, in which we have like 20-minute coffee sessions with just any student who books like an appointment. And basically, if you need help with your resume review, you want me to do a resume review, if you need help with like interviewing or portfolio advice, or just maybe general, like a general Q&A, like I'll be more than happy to do that as well. There's a booking link at this on the screen. And if you want to see the other facilitators as well, definitely check out our social media because it's not just me. There's also people who are part of this program who are experts in software engineering, cloud, and other stuff like that. So definitely check it out. Also, if you do have feedback, like I would really appreciate if you guys could fill in the feedback form as well, which is on the screen right now. This is just to help us kind of gauge how this event was run and how we can like better support you guys in future events. So the link is right there. Please fill it in if you have any feedback for us, because it really helps us like a lot. And then lastly, here are the links as well, the notes and resources. But we will be sending these to you guys as well through email if you registered. So if you haven't registered, the Cutly link is just cut.ly/register and then -design-2020. It's pretty similar to the other links. You just change the first word to register. Same with like the feedback link as well.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, so you guys can take a screenshot of that, and then I'll be going through questions just after this.